Now we get to the Isle of Patmos now to get started. The ninth verse. First place we want to say is the title of this is the Patmos Vision. It took place in AD, between AD 95 and 96. The place was at the Isle of Patmos. Its location is 30 miles off of the coast of Asia Minor, west object of the Ephesian church in the Aegean Sea, bordered by the Mediterranean. That's the position where it's at. Question. The reason why John was there, a godly man, a righteous man, a man of good reputation, good character, never in trouble, why was this man there? The Bible said, for the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. Now, we got the city. The Isle of Patmos, in the Aegean Sea, 30 miles off the coast, approximately 30 miles around it, rocky, full of lizards and scorpions and so forth, and used for a prison house, like Alcatraz is. They get a prisoner, they can't keep in prison here. So such a horrible criminal, they put him out on Alcatraz. And now they took this sainted John the Divine, the last of the disciples, and the only one who died a natural death. John, before going to the island, was accused of being a witch and was boiled in a vat of grease for 24 hours without scorching him.
Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God.
You can't boil the Holy Ghost out of a person.
Hallelujah.
By itself. Boiled him for 24 hours in a vat of grease without any harm, and said the reason the Romans give that he was a witch and bewitched the Greeks. What the carnal mind can think of. Oh, what a setting now. All right. The church then, under John, or under great persecution, John writes the ninth verse, I, John, who also am your brother and companion in tribulation and in the kingdom and in the patience of Jesus Christ, was in the isle that is called Patmos for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. In other words, he took the word of God and was proving it that was the word of God, and Christ came back through him and testified that he was right.
Amen.
John was a prophet, we know that. And so they were asking these questions, so God just had the Roman Empire to pick him up and set him out there on the island and said, now come on, John, I want to show you something that's going to happen. The last of the apostles, there was no more to write it, but John, so they set him out on the Isle of Patmos from AD 95 until AD 96. And he wrote it and he said, I am your brother and companion in tribulation. Now, he got in the Spirit before anything took place. The first thing he did, he was in the Isle called Patmos, all these things that he did, and he said, I heard a voice and all these other things, but before anything took place, he was in the Spirit. And if you notice that in your Bible, big capital Spirit, Holy Spirit, amen. He got in the Spirit. Oh, I just think that's wonderful. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's Day. Be careful, John. You've entered into the Spirit. Something's going to be revealed to you. What is it? A trumpet sound. The first thing, I'm Alpha and Omega. The first of all revelation. Oh, sinner, bow. Repent now before the time's too late. I'm Alpha and Omega. That's the first thing that he let him know who he was. Who's this approaching? Is this King Jesus, King God, King Holy Ghost? He said, I'm all of it. I'm from A to Z. I'm the beginning and the ending. I'm the immortal, eternal one. Now, and I turned to see the voice that spake unto me, and being turned, I saw seven golden candlesticks. My. Did you notice? Stars. Candlesticks. Lamps. What does it mean? What does this mean? That the dispensation that we're living in is nighttime. Candles and lights and stars mean night. And what does a star do? It reflects until the Son returns.
Amen.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Now let's watch him just a little further as we take the rest of this 13th verse. And in the midst, that's the middle, of the golden candlesticks, one like the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the foot, and girded about the paps with a golden girdle. And John shows that he wasn't in the day of his prophecy as a prophet, neither was he come out into the days of his kingship, but he was in the day of the Lord as a judge. Now how many knows that the priest having his girdle, his string around his waistline, meant he was in service? Anyone who reads the Testament and knows the Old Testament knows that. Now watch, he's seven things here he mentions: his head, his hair, his eyes, his feet, his voice. Seven things he mentioned here, the sevenfold glory of Jesus Christ. Let me read it. His head and his hair was white as wool, as white as snow. His eyes were flames of fire. Now notice, the first thing now we notice, his head and his hair was white like wool. His head and his hair was white like wool. Now, it does not mean that he was aged to do this. That wasn't the reason of it. He wasn't aged to do this. It was because of his experience and qualification and his wisdom. Because he's eternal, and eternal cannot age. You understand? Head, hair, eyes were like flames of fire. Think of it. Those eyes, who once was dim with human tears, now has become flames of fire. Now let's see, we're soon down at the end of the page now. Hair like wool, and his eyes were flames of fire, and his feet like brass burned in a furnace. And his voice, the sound of many waters. Voice of many waters. What does water represent? If you want to mark it down, turn to Revelation 17:15, and you'll find that the Bible says the waters which thou sowest is sickness and multitudes and people and tongues. It's a judgment. The voice of the ministers through the Holy Spirit that's crying out to the people. Never age standing there. The voice of many waters. Cry out. Sickness and multitudes. The voice of those seven stars in his hands are ever church age. Preaching the baptism of the Holy Ghost, the baptism in Jesus' name, speaking in tongues, the power of God, the resurrection of Christ, the second coming, divine judgment. The voice of many waters came forth from this one. It looked like the Son of Man. Many waters, watch out. Hair like wool, and eyes like flames of fire, feet like brass, and a voice of many waters. And he had in his right hand seven stars. Now, the seven stars that was in my right hand, he had seven stars in his right hand, which means the seven ministers of seven ages. Boy, it's beautiful. He held them in his right hand. Think, right hand doesn't exactly mean like Christ sitting on God's right hand. It doesn't mean that God's got a right hand because God is the Spirit. But Christ was the right hand of power. And remember, the seven stars was in his right hand. Just think, they were drawing their current, their light from him. They were completely under his control in his right hand. Every true servant of God is the same way. Now, the seventh and last a representation of his person. And out of his mouth goes a sharp two-edged sword. That's the sixth one. Out of his mouth goes a sharp two-edged sword. A sharp two-edged sword. What was going from the mouth of this person? The Word of God. It's a sharp two-edged sword. What was it doing? Discerning the thoughts of the heart. The intent goes even deeper than the meat, the flesh, the blood cells, into the bone, down into the marrow of the bone, follow beyond that, even to a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. That's what the Word of God does. All right. Now, one more quotation. We've come to 20th. So now let's see here on this verse here. Now, the 16th. And he had in his right hand seven stars. Now let's take his countenances. Out of his mouth goes a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenances were like the sun shining in its strength. The prophet couldn't stand no more. See such a vision. He just sapped his strength, and he fell right down at his feet of death. Now watch. And he laid his right hand upon me, saying unto me, Fear not, I am the first and the last. Oh, my. Not a prophet. God. I am the first and the last. I'm the first of the revelation, the last of the revelation. I'm he that was, I'm he that is, I'm he that will come. That's the I am. And he laid his right hand upon me, saying unto me, Fear not, I am the first and the last. I am he that liveth and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Right now. And then he screamed out, Amen. And have the keys of hell and death.
Amen.
Now, he gives a command, and then we start to end the chapter. The 19th verse. Write the things which thou hast seen, and the things which are, and the things which shall be hereafter. We took the 20th verse, the mystery of the seven stars which thou sawest in the right hand are seven golden candlesticks. The seven stars are seven angels of the seven churches, and the seven candlesticks which thou sawest are the seven churches. Oh, it's breathtaking, friend. See him standing there in the supremacy of his deity. He's the judge, the priest, the king, the eagle, the lamb, the lion, the Alpha, the Omega, the Father, Son, Holy Ghost, he that was, which is, and shall come. Turn out the winepress of the fierceness of God and please everything. There John looked up and saw him standing there with feet of brass. Eyes like flames of fire running to and fro throughout the earth. Daniel saw him 700 years before that in the same position, the same kind, same man. Standing there, the Ancient of Days, and one like the Son of Man, that joined in with him. And all judgment was committed to him, stands the white on judgment. Seeing these things, what kind of people ought we to be, friends? God bless you is my prayer. Age was the church of Ephesus. Now the first church age started about AD 53 when Paul established the church in Ephesus. The angel of the first church was St. Paul. He founded it. God's messenger. The first church, the Ephesian church, the works of the church, what God condemned them for was works without love. The reward was the tree of life. The city of Ephesus, one of the three great cities of Asia, often called the third city of Christian faith. First was Jerusalem, second Antioch, and third Ephesus. C, a city of great commerce and trade. E, the government was Roman. F, the language was Greek, and Ephesus was known for its beauty. Ephesus means, the very name Ephesus means, let go, relax, backslidden. Called by God the backslidden church. God acknowledged first their works, their labor, and their patience. God rebuked their living, leaving their first love for backsliding and for no longer bearing life. Ephesus was not a deceived church. It failed itself by not continuing in perfect love. Summary of Ephesus' fruits without love led to apostasy.
the promises, paradise, promised to the overcomer of the saints of Ephesus in the church age, given to the tree of life. Now we see this is the beginning, Pentecost, walking around, the same great God, the same great signs were to take place all down through these ages, because he walked among each age. Blessing what? His people, that the symbol is his name.
Amen.
I want you to watch in this as we go through the church. This church has Jesus' name, and this church lost it. Now, the first verse, what's he doing? He's saluting them. Unto the angel of the church of Ephesus, to John, write these things, saith he that holdeth seven stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. It's a salute. Now, the second verse and the third verse, he commands them. I know thy works and thy labors and thy patience, how that thou cannot bear them which are evil. And thou hast tried them which say they are apostles and are not, and hast found them liars.
Amen.
See, that apostasy had already begun to set in this first age. False teachers rise up. People who were teaching wrong, contrary to the scripture, trying to bring in something or add something. Just don't meddle with God's word, just no matter who it hurts or what it hurts. Just say it anyhow, just the way it's wrote there. That's the way. We don't need any great something else. We don't need any priest or anything to interpret it to us. God, the Holy Spirit, is the interpreter.
Amen.
He gives the interpretation. See how the church began to get far on during that time. They begin to kind of break down. The people, under the inspiration of the Holy Ghost, begin to cause people to kind of make fun of them. Why do I have people to make fun of you? Because you love the Lord Jesus is a blessing just to have to say it. They're only when they're cursing you, they're bringing God's blessings down on you. It backfires on them. And so is the new birth of man. Amen. It'll make you do things that you didn't think you'd do. Stand on a corner and beat a tambourine or sing glory to God. Hallelujah. Praise God. Glory to God. Well, you act like a maniac. That's what it done to the apostles. That's what it done to the Virgin Mary. She acted like she was drunk.
Yes, amen.
She was a mess in society.
Yes.
But it takes a mess for life to come out of.
Yes.
Amen. Unless anything dies and rots, life can't come from it.
Yes.
Unless a man dies and rots in his own thoughts,
yes,
Christ can't get into his heart.
Yes.
That's the way the church was born first.
Amen.
How many believe that God is infinite? Then he cannot change. If that was his idea of a church at the beginning, that's the kind of church you'll have at the end. He cannot change. So how you go to substitute shaking a hand or sprinkling or some other thing that didn't happen right there? Paul went over and found people shouting, having a big time, bunch of Baptists, glorifying God. And he said, Acts 19, he said, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believe? They said, we know it won't be the Holy Ghost. He said, how was you baptized? He said, we've been baptized, but the same man baptized Jesus, John the Baptist, said, it won't work anymore. You've got to be baptized over again.
Yeah.
So he baptized them over again in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, laid his hands up on them, and they had the same kind of results that they had at the beginning.
Amen.
The Holy Ghost fell on them.
Yes,
they began to speak in tongues and prophesy.
Hallelujah.
Now, as I said to begin, before we start off on this again, every revival produces a pair of twins. One's a spiritual man, the other is a natural man of the earth. I know thy works and thy labor and thy patience, how thou cannot bear them which are evil. And thou hast tried them which say that they are apostles and are not, and hast found them liars. He found them to be liars. How'd they know that? They wasn't quoting with the word. Now, if a man says that this Bible says in Hebrews 13:8, Jesus Christ is saying yesterday and forever, and a man says, oh, the days of miracles is past, then that man's a liar. Now, the third verse now. All right, second and third verse. Now, the third verse. And is born and had patience, and for my name's sake has labored and has not fainted for my name. Did you know it? They had patience, labored for what? His name. If you have to do something that you can't do in Jesus' name, let it alone. I'm going to talk about the complaint now in the fourth chapter, the fourth verse rather. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. You left that love that you once had for them good old-fashioned Holy Ghost meetings. And you begin to kind of slide backwards into that farm will come in with, ah, oh, Father, and nonsense, see. If God had that against this church, He's got it against that one too.
Amen.
Because you left your first love, I've got it against you. But where's that first love you once had? Where's that joy you used to have? As David once cried, O Lord, restore to me the joy of my salvation. Where's them all-night prayer meetings and tears on your cheeks? My goodness. The Bible's even dusting got cobwebs on it. The fifth verse, the warning. Remember and repent. See? Remember, therefore, from whence thou art fallen. Where did you come from? From Pentecost, you fell down to where you are now. Backsliding. And repent and do thy first works. Go back to Pentecost again. Or else I will come unto thee quickly and will remove the candlestick out of H-I-S. See who it is, don't you? His place, except thou repent. You got a pastor that really tells you the truth. You ought to honor God, the Savior, Spirit, and worship God. Realize that you're going to be lost if you don't. See? You bring a reproach upon the cause of Christ. Isn't that right? Don't we do it?
Amen.
The bootleggers ain't hurting the church. Isn't that? It is the prostitutes hurting the church. It's the people who profess to be Christians that's hurting the church. But this thou hast. They had something then, didn't they? Now what did they have? That thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Nicolaitan come from the word N-I-C-K-O, Nico, which means to conquer or to overthrow. Nicolaitan, overthrow or conquer the laity. Well, what caused that then? The Nicolaitan. Bring in a bunch of men to twist up the scripture, make a denomination that can't let God move in it. Dies right there. We want to be right. Oh my, it's a serious thing, brother. We've got to get this thing right. We'll never be able to have a church until God gets a foundation to lay it on. He'll never build His church upon a bunch of nonsense. He has to come on His word or He won't come at all. Right on His word. Now let's see if He did. But this thou hast, that thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. God hates an organization. People say, I see them speaking tongues. That still don't mean they got the Holy Ghost.
Right.
I hear them shout. That still don't mean they got the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost is alive.
Yes. Amen.
He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh, I will give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. Now, look, friends. Here's the way you overcome. First you have to overcome, then you can eat the fruit.
Amen.
He was a tree of life. What did He say? How did He fix it? Repent, every one of you, and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
An eternal prescription. It's for you and your children. This will last all down through every church age. Give it to every one of them. That's where you got so many dead churches, so many dead members. You're adding antidote and taking so much away from it, so the prescription ain't itself at all. It won't even heal nothing. Shaking hands and joining churches and sprinkling. Oh, mercy. That's not the prescription, that's death. If you want life, you want the Holy Ghost, follow what God said do. Take the prescription. That's exactly what he said. Don't add to it or take away from it. Then here comes the revelation right over. He said, whoever will take away or add to the same will be taking his part out of the book of life.
Amen.
Oh, my, that's the main doctrine. Oh, I'm loving, don't you?
Amen.
Now, the second church age was called the church age of Smyrna. The Smyrna age come in at 170 and goes to 312. This church is the persecuted church, the one that wears the martyr's crown, is a church of tribulation. And God's promise to it, to the elected church in it, was to give it a crown of life. There's a way made, and God has a way.
Amen.
God has a way for His church, for His people. And He never did intend it to be controlled by popes, cardinals, archbishops, or general overseers. The Holy Spirit is the tutor of the church of the living God.
Amen.
To raise it. Now we're going to start on this Smyrna church age. First, I want to break it down here on some paper that I have. Now, the second church age being Smyrna, and I believe you'll all agree with me, or hope you do, or halfway anyhow, that Ireneus was the star of that church age. He was God's messenger, because he swept the country into France, Gaul, down in there, and he established churches, and every one of them established upon the baptism of the Holy Ghost, speaking in tongues, raising the dead, healing the sick, stopping the rains and performing miracles daily. They know that the living God lived among the people.
Amen.
The reason that I chose Ireneus, because I believe that Ireneus was more closer to the scripture than Polycarp was. And then, as we all know, the great issue was coming at the Nicene Council. One of the great issues was whether God was three or God was one. And Ireneus took the side that God was God. Now, in just one. Now, a city of commerce, a trading outlet to Lydia and to the west. The third largest city in Asia. A great harbor city. Noted for wealth, temples, buildings, schools, medicine, and science. Jews lived at Smyrna. They evangelized the Samaritan people. Polycarp was the first bishop of Smyrna. A persecuted church. God called them persecuted. God looked upon their persecutions and gave grace to bear it. He looked upon his tribulations and gave them victory over death. Looked upon their poverty and gave them riches in Him. The church of Smyrna passed through the fiery furnace of tribulations, but was a sweet-smelling Savior unto him. That's that remnant now, not the whole Smyrna church, just the remnant I'm speaking of. The great 10 days of tribulation means 10 years of the bloodiest persecution. I don't know whether they spell his name or pronounce it or not. This was the emperor at that time, I believe, was the bloodiest one of all of them since Nero in 67. D-I-O-C-L-E-T-I-N. During the year of 303 to 312 A.D., God exhorts Smyrna to be faithful unto death as He was, and I will give you a crown of life as the Father has given me. God promised the overcomer in tribulations the victory over the second death. Fear not them which can kill the body, but he that can destroy the soul, kill the soul. The Samaritans was to endure to the end. Fear not man, and a crown of life will be given you. The persecution of Christianity in the ages are typed in the church ages of Samaria are very important. Now listen to him. Unto the angel of the church of Smyrna, we believe that be Ireneus, write these things, saith the first and the last. See, introduced himself,
I'm God now in this church age. I don't want no four or five different gods around here. I'm God. See? That's it. Which was dead and is alive. Amen. Now, that's the introduction. Now, Smyrna means bitterness. And comes from the word of Myra. And this church had begun to have a root of bitterness coming up in them because that this church, the main church, the big part, a majority of them always, was hammering against the Holy Ghost ruling in the church, and they wanted to rule themselves. But you see, it was a hybrid thing, hybrid.
Amen.
See, it didn't have any life in it.
Amen.
And it cannot go back no more. That's the reason they never rise. But let me tell you something. When the Holy Ghost comes back, it brings new birth and new life.
Amen.
Conversion.
Amen.
Baptism of the Spirit brings the church back to itself again. Puts life back in it. In other words, the root of bitterness is coming up and was choking it out. It was on its throat out to marrow. That's what they anoint bodies with. Myrrh. See? Was myrrh frankincense. The anointment. Myrrh is used to anoint dead bodies after they embalmed them and so forth. Associated with death, and the church was dying. Let's get to the second verse, or that'd be the 8th, 9th verse. All right. Now the persecution. The 9th verse. I know thy works, thy tribulations, poverty, but thou art rich. Oh my. Now he's talking to the church now, the real church, not the others. They hated those deeds of Nicolaitans. I know the blasphemy of them which say they are Jews and are not, but they are the synagogue of Satan. Now, let's take the 10th verse as we read this. Fear none of these things, the synagogue of Satan, which thou shalt suffer. Behold, the devil shall cast you into prison, that ye may be tried, and that you shall have tribulation 10 days. Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life. Oh, my. They were told not to fear when they were called on to die for their religion. Now, this 10 days that they talk of here, the 10 days, a day in the Bible represents a year. And the 10 days was the last 10 years of the reign of this D-I-O-C-L-E-A-T-L and Diocletian. Diocletian. That was that great emperor that reigned in the last. He decided in with this group, and they murdered the Christians and killed them. They burned them. They did everything, and it was 10 years of the most bloody persecution. And his time and his reign was from 302 until 312. That ended the Smyrna age with the issuing in of Constantine. Now, the 11th verse is a promise. Now, we'll have this just before closing. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith to the churches. He that overcometh shall not be hurt of the second death. Now, overcomes the Nicolaitans, overcomes the things of the world,
amen,
overcomes these denominations,
amen,
overcomes these priesthoods,
amen,
overcomes everything in the world, and sells out and loves Christ.
Amen.
He'll not be hurt of the second
amen
death. Why? He's got eternal life.
Hallelujah.
Eternal life can't die.
Amen.
Jesus said, he that heareth of me has eternal life,
amen,
shall never die. I'll raise him up in the last day. Now death, the word death comes from is separation. Now, when we are separated from God in sin, we're already dead. The Bible said so. We're alienated from God. We're cut off. We're dead in sin and trespasses. We're alien to God, into His commonwealth. And then when we receive God and have eternal life, we are His children and a part of Him. And the blood test shows whether you're God's or not. See? You're God's children and you have eternal life. But the soul that sinneth, that soul shall be separated. Is that right? Then it will be no more. The first death is separating from our loved ones. We're going to the presence of God, never out of His presence. See? Now, if there's a second death, then it has to be the death of the soul. And then he that overcomes the world, overcomes the things of the world, has eternal life and shall not be touched by the second death. There you are. Eternal life. Would you be willing to be a martyr for him, a Samaritan? If it come to the spot that you had to face death or take it back, would you face it?
Yes, sir.
Hallelujah. I love him, don't you?
Yeah.
I'm so glad I had eternal life. That doesn't bother me anymore because we have eternal life now, and I know that, and I trust that everybody will have it, all of us.
Now, on the background of this church, it's the third church age called Pergamos, and the date that this church existed was from 312 to 606. The age was false doctrine, Satan lying, the foundation of papacy rule, and marriage to church and state. The reward was hidden manna, a white stone. And the star, the angel of this church, that by all that the Holy Spirit would let me do, I have picked St. Martin. And he was a great man. Now, to the angel of the church of Pergamos, write these things, and it saith, he which has the sharp sword with two edges. Well, the sword is the Word. Hebrews 4, we tuck it in the beginning. When we run that deity of Him down, the sword we found in Hebrews 4:12, that was a Word of God, was sharper than a two-edged sword. Now, we want to notice here, again now in the second verse, that which would be the 13th, I know thy works and where thou dwellest, even Satan's seat. And thou holdest fast my name, and hast not denied my faith. See, they're living where Satan is seated, and still they're keeping the name of Jesus. Not denying my faith, even as those in the days wherein, I guess you pronounce that A-N-T-I-P-S, Antipas, was my faithful martyr, who was slain among you, where Satan dwelleth. I'm going to stop there just a minute. Satan's seat. We want to kind of exercise on these things. I want you to catch it. Be sure you do now. Satan's seat. Now, God pronounced in Genesis where Satan's seat was, and that was in Babylon. It's always been Satan's seat. And in Revelations, it was the same thing.
Amen.
But if you notice, Babylon changed itself from pagan to papal. Now, in the early years, or just before this taking place a few years, Satan's seat, there the great, I guess you would call him a pre-king priest of the Chaldeans, the hierarchy of Babylon, changed his seat when the Persians was pursuing him, and he left Babylon. His name was Attalus, Attalus, the great king priest of Babylon. When the Persians came in and taking over Babylon, running out the Chaldeans, Attalus, their king priest, fled and took his seat at Pergamos. The Satan seat is where you are dwelling. Get it?
Amen.
I thought, well, where could that be? A certain thing Satan see. Then I find out that this great king, after he was fleeing from the conquering Persians that had taken over according to Daniel's vision, he came to this city of Pergamus at Rome, and there made his headquarters. Satan shifted his headquarters from Babylon to Pergamus, where future he would start the new Babylon. The true church has never changed its attitude. Not to be ruled by some board of I don't know what you do, call them either cardinals and bishops and popes, the infallible ones. We believe there's one infallible one. He is our King. He's Jesus Christ with us now in the form of the Holy Spirit. God in us, living among us, leading us and guiding us unto the waters of life, making himself known, showing as he did among those early saints and martyrs that he was the Lord God of creation, healing the sick, raising the dead. Amen. Showing visions, casting out devils. Remember, the true church has always been the little bitty group that's been pushed out of the other churches. The true church never was organized. Because it's not an organism. It is the mystical body of Jesus Christ living on earth. The Holy Spirit moving in these members.
Amen.
Now, so Constantine, with this in his mind, to strengthen his empire, as Rome always did, to hold the keys to the world, he had to bring his pagan ideas and take the Christian ideas and some way consolidate them together to weld this together and make himself an empire that would be second to none. See? Because that he was, that would make him yet the greatest ruler in the world. Constantine. As far as conversion, he was a politician, but not a saint of God, as some of them try to make him. He wasn't. Never one thing did he ever do that even sounded like Christianity to me. So on the one of the Nicolaitan churches, he put a cross. And as far as anything else he ever done, it looked Christianity. I never seen it. Unless that night he painted them on his shields, like because he had a dream, the Christians was praying for him that he'd win the battle. Now, then it would strengthen his empire. And then to do this, he brought in pagan ceremonies over into the Nicolaitan Christian church. I'll call it the formal denominational church that was forming. He brought pagan ceremonies over into this Nicolaitan church, and that was the birth of Catholicism. But God has a plan, but man wants to make his own plan. Hybriding. God's plan. All right. Now, in doing this, they consolidated and made the early form, the early Catholic Church later. Then at the first great Nicene Council, when I read that, I just fell on my knees. The great Nicene Council had taken place in AD 325. All of them was brought together. The bishops and fathers of the Christian faith was brought together at Nicaea. That's the reason it's called the Nicaea Council. In AD 325, and about 1,500 delegates came to the convention or the council. About 1,500 delegates. And the laity outnumbered the bishops 5-1 in the delegation. But yet, through the Nicolaitans, the co-formals, and Constantine's politicianal plan, they outvoted the true church and won the victory and issued in bishops and holy order of man taking this, the Holy Spirit from the meeting and placing it up on bishops, cardinals, and popes and so forth. Now he said here in the Bible here, hold fast my faith. Now, have a few things against thee, because thou hast there them, not these here, but there they have them. You have them in the Pergos church. See, holding the doctrine of Balaam, who taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel, to eat things sacrificed unto idols and to commit fornications. Now, the word Pergamos means married. The very word Pergamos means married. Christianity, that is the Nicolaitan side, the formal side, married to the state with pagan ceremonies. Pagan ceremonies, and it was the birth of the Catholic Church in that day. That's the same thing had taken place here, the Nicene Council. Nicolaitans, formal Christianity, and the Holy Spirit comes back and said, you've got the doctrine of Balaam among you. See? And I hate them deeds of the Nicolaitans, them doctrines that they got, because it's a doctrine of Balaam, who taught the children of Israel to stumble. How did he do it? Then when he went out to curse that people, God said, I'll tie up your tongue. You can't stand by what I tell you. You can't curse what I've blessed. So he looked down there. Now remember, the denomination is what God is calling injected into the doctrine of Balaam. Well then, when he could not get them into this denomination, you know what Balaam done? Now listen close now. We're coming close to the close. Now, what Balaam done, he done the very same thing they done here at the Nicene Council. That's the reason he said you've got the doctrine of Balaam and those Nicolaitans. Look, what was Babylon? Who founded Babylon? Nimrod. What did he do? He made one big tower in a big city and made all the other cities pay tribute to this city.
Amen.
Organization.
Amen.
That's the backgrounds of it.
Amen.
Sure, come right over here in the church age and organized again and brought the whole nations into it. And Balaam said, now I'll tell you, Balak, I'll give you a good idea. God won't curse them, that's all there is to it. So I'll tell you what we'll do. We can't get rid of them, but if you just invite them over, you'll swing the whole thing your way. What did they do? Balak's teaching come down amongst Israel, and they invited all the Israelites up to this big feast, the big blowout they had. Oh, some big party shindig of a thing up there they had. And when they committed spiritual fornications up there, the church married from the baptism of the Holy Ghost to a denomination, they become dead. There you are. What the Bible said. That's what God said. Speaking to the churches. Pergamos wasn't invited. Alright, they was invited to a feast after the Nicene Council. They was invited to the feast of winter solstice, which means the sun, worship of the sun, which was a pagan god, which fell on December the 21st, the shortest day in the year. Praise God. And I just help just for a minute. 17th verse. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone, and in the stone a new name, written which no man knoweth, save he that receiveth. This is a special bread. A special bread, hidden manna. What is it? Who is our manna? Christ. All right, St. John, the 6th chapter, 48th to the 50th verse, if you're putting it down. Jesus said he was the bread of life that come from God out of heaven, the manna.
Now, white rock. He shall have a white rock, this angel shall have. A white stone, that's a rock, isn't it? And dry purity. A new name written in this rock that nobody knows but he himself. He knows who he is, but he can't tell others. Oh, how I love him. And we're tonight on the church age of the fourth church age, Thyatira, great church age known as the Dark Age. This church age starts in 606 and ended at 1520. And I've got his history kind of written down here. First, the fourth church age, Thyatira. It means to be laxed, loose, or hazy. See? It was just an illegitimate time. From 606 to 1500, the star was Columba from Ireland and Scotland, which was a nephew to St. Martin. He never did accept the Roman doctrine. He was a great man of faith. He rejected the Roman teaching, never did go to Rome, and rejected it altogether. He heard God's audible voice calling. That's another good sign to him. Then nothing could stop him after that. He was gone.
All right.
He was on the road when he heard the audible voice of God.
All right.
One miracle, I got several down here, but we just take this one. One miracle was that when he had went to a certain city that the Lord had sent him to, and the city didn't want to receive him. So they went out there and tried to tuck the musicians and so forth and close the gates and tried to drown him out by playing the musicians. And he began to preach and drowned out the musicians. The gates come open, he went on in, preached anyhow, and got the whole bunch converted. His church was filled with the Holy Ghost. He would have nothing less, for every member of his church must be filled with the Holy Ghost. Now, we find then tonight, we start out to the angel of the church of Thyatira, write these things, saith the Son of God, who has eyes like flames of fire, and his feet like fine brass. We've seen his feet was fine brass and so forth, which meant his foundation. He tread the winepress of the wrath of Almighty God and tramped down and tucked sin upon him and waited out and pleased God. That's right. And his foundation is our foundation. On Christ's solid rock I stand, said Eddie Pruitt, all other grounds is sinking sand.
That's right.
He's looking down into Laodicea, down into Thyatira. This is the age that the church has married into Catholicism and paganism, or Nicolaitanism and paganism, wedded together and formed and gave birth to the first church, organized church. All right. I know thy works and thy charity and thy service and faith and thy patience and thy works, and the last to be more than the first. But now, we're going to take the 20th verse. Listen to this. Notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee, because thou sufferest that woman Jezebel, which calls herself a prophetess, to teach and subdue my servants and commit fornications to eat things sacrificed unto idols. Now, Jezebel, if you'll notice, this is a great history. Now, if you want to write it down, start in 1 Kings about 16. Jezebel was not a daughter of Abraham. Neither was this group over here, the pagan Rome. The Nicolaitans was a cold, formal bunch of Christians that had separated themselves from the real Christians, seemingly not having the faith. And they wanted to make the church like a lodge, the same as they got today, like a lodge, no spirit in it all. Days of miracles has passed. All that was for another age. We got a brotherhood. Now, what did he say over here to this tonight? The same thing that Ahab did. Ahab
to strengthen his kingdom, married Jezebel, this idolatress, to strengthen his kingdom, to get more strength into Israel. Oh, them things to try to increase, they take God's holy things and scatter them anyway to increase and make a lot of numbers. That's what the church done. It accepted people into it on the basis of shaking hands and got renegades and everything else.
Amen.
Unregenerated people, but into the true body of Christ, which is not an organization, but the mythical body of Christ. You can only come in there in one way, and that's through the baptism of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Ahab, the hypocrite. See, he goes over and he says, now, if I could just consolidate, now I'd get this big nation, if I marry that old boy's daughter down there, well, that we'll be friends. What was he doing? Selling his very birthrights. Now, if you notice, Ahab married Jezebel to strengthen his people. That's exactly what Constantine did. He set up a great big church and took the altar and made a big marble, dressed this man up, Pope, set him up on there. He was a living God. He could talk to him and tell her about their sins, and that just pleased that old lukewarm church in a way they went. Sure, that's it. Well, but that didn't please that man who was born again. When they take that man, bring in pagan ceremonies of saying the prayers, what did they do? They taken down Jupiter and put up Peter. They took down Venus and put up Mary. And it brought paganism into the Christian ranks. And when Ahab married Jezebel, he did the very same thing else. He brought idolatry into Israel.
Amen.
And what did Jezebel do? She killed every prophet she could get her hands on.
Amen.
Is that right?
Amen.
So did the popes.
Amen.
Every true Christian get their hands on, they killed him. But there was a star of that age.
Amen.
Old Elijah.
Amen.
Oh, yes, sir.
Hallelujah.
He wasn't scared to tell him about it. Yes,
Glory.
Sir.
Hallelujah.
He was God's star of that age.
Amen.
Got down to one time and said, Lord, I'm the only one left. God said, now, wait a minute, Lance. I done got 700 hit out around in the inner sea. You don't know where they're at. They're out there in the Pharisees, Sadducees, Baptists, Methodists, and Presbyterians. But I'll get them out there. You just wait. I've got them out there. They're mine. They're not bowed to need of Balaam yet. But old Elijah was the voice of God in that day. He sure was the very type of the voice of God. It's the first coming of Christ. It'll be the type of the voice in the second coming of Christ again, according to the scriptures. Now, Balaam was the one who made it whoredom with Israel. And what did the Nicolaitans do? Made the organization. So put them both together and you got a herd. Church.
Amen.
Sure. Revelation 17, the great whore that sets upon many waters. Woman, prostitute. What is she? How is she a prostitute? She's committing fornication, spiritual fornication, misinterpreting the word to the people.
Amen.
Get away from that fanaticism. That's real fanaticism. Right. Now, she had children. Did the real Jezebel have children? Yes, sir. Listen. I'll kill her children. But the Catholic Church, her children, is a Protestant denomination. Exactly, because they're doing the same thing, baptized right into her by their freak baptism, unscriptural baptism, shaking hands for the Holy Ghost, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost instead of Jesus Christ, and just doing everything contrary to the Bible still, and they walk right into it. Her daughter was called Athaliah, A-T-H-A-L-I-A-H. She had Jezebel had Aletha married to Jerome, the son of King of Judah, and soon the altars of Balaam was standing in Jerusalem. You don't have to go to history of that, that's Bible. See? Her daughter Aletha married Jehoshaphat's son, which was Jerome, and her daughters did the same thing she did. What kind of a death does their children be killed with? You see, they're dead now.
Amen.
Spiritually dead.
Amen.
They have no revelation. 22nd verse. And I will cast her into a bed, and them that commit adultery with her unto the great tribulation, the great tribulation,
That's what's going through. Now remember, let me stop here just a minute. That great tribulation is that which they're going to throw in there is those people that are the sleeping virgin. They didn't have oil in their lamps, yet they belong to an organization, good people, went to church or everything, but they come for oil, but too late then. See, throw her into great tribulation. She'll go in that. The Catholic Church goes in. All of her children goes in with her into great tribulation. Except they repent of their deeds. That don't have no more to do with it. Nothing. You could belong to 4011 of their organization. But are you a born again child of God? Really, do you love everybody with all your heart, with your soul? And you love God in your daily, no matter what anyone does to you. You wrapped in, like a bus all that shows the Holy Spirit's departing.
Now, the real Nicolaitans, the co-farmers that wanted that organization, they married into it here. And now notice the same thing, they got Jezebel here, the Catholic Church, and down here, she takes her daughter, her organization, and marries it right in June down there, does the same thing to them.
Amen.
Kill her children with death, spiritual death. Organize themselves to death, and the first thing you know, all the spirits gone. That organization, as soon as you organize, they're dead.
Amen.
He said, I'll kill her children with death. Oh, I know you. Please don't feel bad at me, but if I know this and don't tell it, I'm a low-down hypocrite, and God will hold me responsible for it.
Amen.
I will be like Paul, a shun not to declare the whole counsel of God.
Amen.
That's right.
Amen.
All right. All right, now let's finish up right quick because it's past time now. All right, but I say, let's see now, I got the 23rd verse. And I will kill her children with death, and all the churches shall know that I am he which searches the reins and hearts, and I will give unto every one of you according to your works. But unto you, I say, and to the rest in Thyatira, as many as has not this doctrine. What kind of doctrine was it? Organization. Bishops, archbishops, and popes, see, has not this doctrine. Now, the Bible, we found out last night, Israel coming through Moab, they was not a nation. They dwelt upon the face of the earth, and they was a people free. Is that right? The type wonders about tents and so forth. The Pentecost groups is the same way. The true Pentecost wonder about place to place. All right. It has not this doctrine of organizing herself and making a great organization out of it, which has not this, and which have not known the depths of Satan. There won't be no more burden. It's what you've already got. This little minority that's in there. See, that's all squeezed out in this dark age. That's pretty much 1,500 years he went through that. But that which you have already, hold fast till I come. In other words, you've got the Pentecostal blessing still in your heart. Hold that till I come to give you relief. This next age is just coming up in the next time. He that overcometh and keepeth my words unto the end, to him I will give the power over the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron, and as a vessel of the potter shall they be broken into shivers, even as I received of my Father. You see, that church, what will it be when that dark age church rises to stand in judgment against that pagan bunch of back there? Will they be rolled down? That brass seal tramp right through there. I tell you, you break them into shivers, the Bible said. And I will give unto him the morning star. You know what that is, don't you? Christ is the morning star. All right. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. Isn't he wonderful?
Amen.
I love him. Now tonight we're beginning on the fifth church age, which is the church age of Sardis. S-A-R-D-I-S. Sardis. And the messenger to this church age is Martin Luther. Becomes more familiar to the Bible scholar, or this teacher, or the laity rather today. And that church age began in 1520 and ended in 1750. 1520 to 1750. And the age of what we call Reformation Age. And the complaint was using their own name. And the reward for the little remnant that was left
was to walk before him in white raiment and their names in the Lamb's Book of Life. May the Lord bless us as we undertake now. And so, Sardis. Now we start out the very word Sardis, the first verse. The word Sardis in the English terms means, if you want to look it up, means the escape one. Now, let's take the first verse. Unto the angel of the church of Sardis write thee, saying, saith he that has seven spirits of God and the seven stars, I know thy work, that thou hast a name that thou livest and art dead. If you notice this is wrote here, the writer note. Look, the seven spirits. Watch. Capital S.
Amen.
Holy Spirit, only one of them.
Amen.
The same Holy Spirit coming seven times to all seven church ages, bearing the same light.
Amen.
Get it now?
Amen.
Seven church ages, seven times this Holy Spirit would carry this same message. Look, he used the spirit of Elijah. And when Elijah went away, Elisha received the double portion of it. And when Elisha got sick and dying, then he come back again on John the Baptist. Same thing made him act, just like Elijah did, living in the wilderness and so forth. Is that right? And predicted to come again.
Amen.
In the last days. See? God uses the Spirit right on down. The same Holy Spirit that filled Paul with the Holy Ghost, the things that he done, will fill this Ireneus full of the Holy Ghost, fill Martin full of the Holy Ghost, fill the rest of them full of the Holy Ghost, and fill you and I full of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
And it's the Pentecostal blessings from one church age to the other.
Amen.
Alpha and Omega, the end and the beginning and all.
Amen.
Root and offspring of David, morning star, rose of Sharon, lily of the valley, whatever more. Father, Son, Holy Ghost,
Amen.
He that was, which is, and shall come, Alpha, Omega, all. All in all.
Amen.
Oh, I believe we'll just carry on just a little bit with this first one yet. I know thy works. Thou hast a name that thou livest and art dead. Turn over to the next church here. You find out, but thou hast not denied my name. Following church, not denied my name. But in this church, you have a name.
Amen.
Watch here. This church kept his name. This church kept his name. This church kept his name. And this church went through a dark age and there's nothing said about it. When it come out to the life on this side, the first little escape one, when Luther pulled him out, you have a name.
Amen.
That you are alive, but you are dead.
Amen.
Now, what name did they use after they quit using Jesus' name? Father, Son, Holy Ghost.
Amen.
And there ain't no such a thing.
Amen.
It's a dead theology.
Amen.
Now, notice this. Now, let's read the next verse. Watch. Be watchful and strengthen the things which remains that are ready to die. For I have not found thy works perfect before God. Isn't that beautiful? Oh my, I love it. Not perfect. Why? They were just justified.
Amen.
Luther preached justification.
Amen.
They had to be sanctified and then filled with the Holy Ghost. And then they wasn't their own. They were perfected by the Holy Spirit in them. Not the Christian that's perfect. It's the perfect Holy Spirit in him.
Amen.
That's why, as I said, it ain't the holy mountain. It's the holy God on the mountain.
Amen.
Not the holy church. Not the holy people. But it's the Holy Ghost in the church.
Amen.
And in the people.
Amen.
That's the holy part. See? Things that are ready to die. Hold on to them. Now he says here, now in the third verse, remember, therefore, how thou hast received and heard. I like that. And hold fast and repent. If therefore thou shalt not watch, I will come unto thee as a thief, and thou shalt not know the hour that I come upon thee. Hold fast to your justification. Stick to it. Don't let them people stop that back away from you.
Amen.
That also that you have received, you heard. They read the same Bible that we read, see? But they just didn't take all of it because it wasn't revealed to them. It wasn't farther reach.
Amen.
That's the reason that they'll come forth in the resurrection. They walked in what light they had to walk in. So they'll come forth. All right. Hold fast that which you've heard, lest it die. Now, the fourth verse, I believe it is. Thou hast a few names, even in Sardis, which have not defiled their garments, and they shall walk with me in white, for they are worthy. Let's see now. He that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before the angels. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the church. God trying to warn them here to stay out of this Nicolaitanism. Stay away from there. Keep their garments unspotted from any things of the world. Just stay free in him, and he would lead them to God. Now, that's the first beginning. Now, the escape ones is the one he's talking about. That's these right here. This little bitty group here that's living by justification. Now look, they come out, they seen the light. Luther turned right after the death of Luther, not Luther. Luther never made no organization. Is that bunch after him?
Amen.
Wesley never made no organization. Is that group after him?
Amen.
Them old founders of Pentecost never made an organization. Is the group after them?
Amen.
That's
Amen.
The one that does it, see? It's the second round that does it. The real angel of life will never make an organization.
Amen.
You'll find out on this Pentecostal age what comes at the end of that organization too. See, when the Holy Spirit reveals it to us. Now, he said, you've got a little bit of life left. Just a little bit. It's ready to die. It's dwindling. It's just justification. They can swing anyway. You haven't got any life yet because you took the wrong name. But your peace, you've been snatched out. See? You've escaped the Roman church. Now, the church age began about 1520. When the Roman universal Catholic Church had full swing that lasted until October the 31st, if you're all putting it down, October the 31st, 1570 A.D., when Martin Luther nailed his 95th thesis on the church door in Wittenberg, Germany, and from that time the Reformation was on.
Amen.
From that date, the Reformation set in. The fire began to fly.
Oh,
he protested that Catholic Church, standing that in his hand like that. He said, this being the holy body of Christ, it's a wafer and a little wine and whammy you throw it on the floor. That's right. Now, it was a great political rally. But it was not for the Holy Scriptures and the Holy Ghost. It was a political rally that he did get rid of some of the old relics of the crucifix and Hail Marys and all of that.
Amen.
What we need is a back to the Bible and the Holy Ghost, brother, and the power of the resurrected Christ and the church working signs and wonders and miracles.
Amen.
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 That's the gospel.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Yes. Brought forth, yes, that's right, it did. The revival done some pretty good things, that revival. But it didn't bring forth the Holy Ghost. They didn't bring that forth down this later seeing age, down the Pentecostal age. But it did do one thing. This revival done some things that he said, don't let it die now. Strengthen it, keep adding to it.
Amen.
See? It brought forth the free Bible to the people again.
Amen.
The Lutheran age brought forth the free Bible.
Amen.
They made their press and began to give the world the Bible. God bless the Lutherans for that.
Amen.
Yes, sir. They put the Bible back in the laity's hand again. Was just priest alone. So now, the Lutheran revival, what they wanted to strengthen, now you've got the Bible in your hand, now read it.
Amen.
Believe it. Don't lay it up on the shelf and say, well, we got a Bible. That ain't going to do you no good up there.
Amen.
Too many Lutherans in Pentecost today,
right,
laying the Bible around and taking what somebody else says about it.
Amen.
Brother, read the Word.
Amen.
Search the Scriptures, for they are they which testify of me, said Jesus. In them you think you have eternal life. That's the thing to do. Read the Word. They did turn from idols
And they turned from idols. That is true. They took down the idols out of the church. Mary, Joseph, and Peter, Paul, and all them. They turned from the idols, but they did not turn to the risen Christ.
Amen.
Luther turned them from the idols, but into more like a politic or a denominational organization to make himself just another organization, an image like the first one, and try to outgrow it by their denomination. Looky, resurrect that. If this book falls to the floor, now to take another book and take it in its place isn't restoration, resurrection. You have to bring the same one up. Amen. So if the church died through the dark ages and become completely pagan back here, then the restoration, that's a reformation, to reform. But to be reformed and born again is two different things. See? They brought back reformation, reforming, getting away from a lot of their idols and so forth, but they never brought the Holy Ghost back in the church.
Amen.
Oh, blessed be the name of the
Amen.
Lord.
Amen.
Brother, sister, can you see it?
Amen.
They never brought the Holy Ghost back, because the one that really brings the true gospel life, put on your cap now,
Amen.
The one that brings the true gospel life is the angel of the church down here.
Amen.
Don't you love it?
Amen.
Oh, my.
Hallelujah.
This good Holy Spirit gospel. Oh, how I love it. I love him with all my heart. And tonight the church age is called the Philadelphian church age. And the star or the messenger, angel messenger to that church age, we believe solemnly with all of our heart to be John Wesley. The church age began at 1750 when the Lutheran church age went out and lasted up to somewhere in 1900, around 1906 AD, the Wesleyan church age. Now, the age is the age of church age of brotherly love, the great missionary age, and the open door age. And the reward was a pillar, made a pillar, and the revelation of three names: the name of God, the name of city of God, God's new name, is a revelation that was given to this church. John Wesley was the star of the age, and he was born on June the 17th, 1703, in Epworth Rectory, England. Father, a preacher. Mother, a consecrated saint. Although with 19 children to take care of, she found much time through her busy day to teach her children Bible lessons, Bible stories, and pray for them. That's what made the boys what they were. The great songwriter, Charles, his brother, who gave the world some of the most inspiring songs we've ever had. John rose up early every morning. For 60 years, he got up every morning at 4 o'clock. That's one thing the church is falling from. Got up every morning at 4 o'clock and preached at 5 a.m. for 50 years straight. And sometimes he preached from 2 to 4 times a day. It is said by people of England that he rode a horse 4,500 English miles every year to preach the gospel. I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door, and no man can shut it. For thou hast a little strength, and hast kept my word, and hast not denied my name. Now, watch the time coming now. After the great missionary move that swept across the nations, of brotherly love, to take what they had, nothing against it, of literature and whatever more, into the different parts of the world. Now, the church denomination had gone back to education works again. See, gone back.
After the great denomination had been set up, Jesus set an open door. After the Wesleyan age had come in and the Methodist Church had been established in the earth, taking roots, growing, making a great church, which it is today, one of the greatest among the Protestant churches. And that time, the thing that took place then was Jesus set an open door for the church before they entered into the Laodicean age. Oh, here's where you have to watch now. It's just in between the Philadelphian and the Laodicean age. Lap over. Jesus is the door.
Amen.
Now, if you'll turn with me to John 10:17. Then said Jesus unto them, Verily, verily, I say unto you, I am the door of the sheepfold. Let's back into the blessings. How do we get into Christ? What is He? The sheepfold. Now remember, we're not talking against anybody. The good people is scattered. God's sheep is in all that places out there. That is true. That's right. Methodists, Baptists, whatever they are, they're God's people if they're born again of the Spirit of God. After that began to come along, the first thing you know, they organized the old general council, which went in now called the Assemblies of God. See, all that church that was left over. I know thy works. Behold, I set before thee an open door, and no man can shut it. Thou hast a little strength and has not denied my name. No man can be saved only through Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Not through any church, any organization, any bishop, pope. Just through Jesus Christ. He has the key. He's the only one. The keys of what? David. The future coming millennium, where He'll sit on the throne of David. I have the keys of David.
Amen.
I open this door and nobody can shut it. Nobody can open it but me, and nobody can shut it to me. For thou hast a little strength. You got just a little strength now. What does that mean? Just like a man that's been dead, kind of shaking himself, coming alive, reviving up a little. Oh, don't you see, brethren, what you've done? You went right straight back to the thing that God hated. Break up brotherhood. Look at the Assemblies of God. Some of the finest people in the world is in them Assemblies of God. Look at that United Pentecostal Church, just as fine as you ever met in your life. Look at the Church of God. And because of those organizations, they fuss and squeal and fuss at one another, call one another buzzards, roosters, and rat den. Why, it's a disgrace. One thing God hates is sowing discord among brethren. That's right. And those organizations is what does it. Sows discord among brethren. We should be standing in the breach and saying, we are brothers. And no man shutteth it, for thou hast a little strength, and hast kept my word, all right, and hast not denied my name. Behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews, which say they are spirit-filled Christians. Say the synagogue, the organization. I'll make them, it says they got the Holy Ghost and all organized up there. They haven't even got the revelation yet. See? All right. I'll say them, say they are Jews, are Christians, and are not, but do lie. Behold, I will make them come and worship before thy feet and to know that I have loved thee. Now, we're going to watch now. We're coming over into something that's very dangerous. All of them live a good, clean life, sanctified, and think it's got the Holy Ghost. And you're a fellow speaking tongues or something, you laugh at him, make fun of him, say it's the devil. Brother, you sealed your doom when you did that. You blaspheme the Holy Ghost, which is unpardonable. Because thou hast kept the word of my patience, I also will keep thee, that little remnant, from the hour of temptation, when the church is going to come to a place where you're going to have to get this organization you're going to have it, brother. That's all. You're either going to be organized or take the mark of the beast. That shall come upon the whole world to try them that dwell upon the earth. Behold, I come quickly. Hold fast to that which thou hast, that no man take away thy crown. A crown means that you have a domain. You are a king if you're crowned.
Amen.
See? And we are sons of God when we're crowned with eternal life, and our domain is the earth. Make you priests and kings unto God. Is that right? So there you are. He that overcometh, will I make a pillar in the temple of my God. A pillar or a foundation. Foundation in the temple of the house or the house of God. The temple of my God or the house of my God. It's a pillar. The foundation. Everything went in the door.
Amen.
Jesus.
Hallelujah.
And he that overcometh, will I make him a pillar. In other words, part of the foundation. What will I give him? I'll put in him the doctrine of the apostles and prophets from the beginning. And give him the revelation. Make him a, he'll overcome, make him a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go no more out. A pillar in the temple of my God, and I will write up on him the name of my God. Now, what's the name of God? Jesus.
Amen.
If you don't jot this down, we're getting a little late. Jesus, Ephesians 3:15 says, in heaven and earth, all's named Jesus, you see. All right, and the name of the city of my God, which is the New Jerusalem, which comes down out of heaven from my God. I'll put on him, if you see, it's all the same name as you already called it. See? I'll put on him the name of the city of my God. The city, he goes ahead and say, which is the New Jerusalem. See? The New Jerusalem. I'll put on him the New Jerusalem. Now, the bride or the church is the New Jerusalem.
Amen.
How many knows that?
Amen.
The church itself is the New Jerusalem.
Amen.
You believe that?
Amen.
Which is all the same. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And the bride married to Jesus makes it Miss Jesus and so forth. See? The city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, which comes down from God out from heaven from my God, and I will write upon him my new name. Don't you love him? Isn't he wonderful? Now we're tonight take the end of the Laodicea. We believe that the Laodicean church started in AD 1906. I predict, now remember, predict, especially you listen at the tape. I don't say it will be, but predict that it will end by 1977. That the church will go completely into apostasy and she'll be ousted out of the mouth of God. And the second coming or the rapture of Christ might come anytime. Now I can miss that a year. I can miss it 20 years. I can miss it 100 years. I don't know where, but I just predict that. According to a vision he showed me and taking the time, the way it's progressing. But the Lord showed me a vision of the great powerful woman in 1933, its own paper, how that Roosevelt helped cause the world to go to war, how that Mussolini would make his first invasion to Ethiopia, he would take it, but he'd come to a disgraceful end, how that then the three-ism, Nazism, fascism, and communism would all wind up in communism. Watch Russia, the king of the north, see? What he would do, for all those isms will heap up into Russia. Then I said that this nation would finally go to war with Germany. I said, then I seen they're going to permit women and are permitting women to vote. And by voting, they'll elect the wrong man some of these days. And you did it the last election.
Yeah.
As we see, it's just a bunch of politics rotten to the
Amen.
Core.
That's right.
That's all. Sure. There is no salvation in this nation. There's no salvation in any nation.
Amen.
Salvation's in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
This nation is a woman's nation.
Amen.
The flag was made by a woman. It's number 13. She started out 13 stars, 13 stripes, 13 colors. Everything's 13, 13, 13. Right on down. 13 stars on her silver dollar now. Everything's a 13. It's number 13 that appears in the 13th chapter of Revelation. Completely 13. Everything is woman, 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 right on down. She took over all the offices.
She's took over Hollywood. She's took over the nations. She's took over the offices. She's took over everything there is. Equal rights with the man, votes with the man, cusses like a man, drinks like a man, anything else. And just bait for the Catholic Church for the worship of a woman.
Amen.
They're already worshiping a woman anyhow. Immoral woman is the best bait the devil ever had. She's worse than all the bar rooms that ever was. She can send more souls to hell than all the bar rooms in the country. That's right. A good woman is a jewel in a man's crown, said the wisest man on earth. A man ought to honor a good woman. See? But an evil one is water in his blood, and his blood is his life. You men's got good wives. You don't know how you are to thank God for a good wife. For if God could have given a man anything better for a helpmate, he'd have done it.
Yes.
Now, the Lady Osea, that the Lady Osean age, the word means lukewarm. It's increased with goods and thinks she has need of nothing. But the Bible says that she's wretched, blind, miserable, and naked. What a condition. The reward to them that overcome in this church age is to sit on the throne with the Lord. Now, the star or angel or messenger of this church age is unknown. The angel of this Lady Osean church, they ended up, now he will be at the end of the age like the rest of them, like the Bible. He will be a mighty prophet that will be rejected by the church world. For they will go right on in their sins and finally be spewed out of the mouth of God. I believe it will be one like Elijah. I'm going to give my reasons why. For behold, the day cometh that shall burn as an oven. And all the proud, yea, all that do wickedly, shall be stubbles. And the day that cometh thou shall burn them up, saith the Lord of hosts, and it shall leave them neither root nor branch. But to you that fear my name, the Son of Righteousness shall rise with healing in his wings, and you shall go forth and grow up as calves of a stall. And you shall tread down the wicked, for they shall be ashes under the soles of your feet, and that in the day that I shall do this, saith the Lord of hosts. Not the day that he shall burn the earth. We'll tread upon their ashes. That's the millennium, of course, see? Remember the law of Moses my servant, which I commanded him in Horeb, for all Israel's with the statutes and judgment. Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming and great and dreadful day of the Lord. And he shall turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the hearts of the children to the fathers, lest I come and smite the earth with a curse. That's exactly right. Luke 1:17. All right. Now you can mark it down. And thou shalt have joy and gladness, and many shall rejoice at his birth. For he shall be great in the sight of the Lord, and shall drink neither wine nor strong drink. This man that comes forth will be taught from his birth not to drink or to have anything to do with sin like that. You get it?
Yes, amen.
And he shall be filled with the Holy Ghost even from his mother's womb. And many of the children of Israel shall return to the Lord their God, and he shall go before him in the spirit and the power of Elias to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, and make ready a people prepared for the Lord. Now listen close now. And he shall turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the hearts of the children to the fathers. Now when this great Elijah comes in the end of this age, he'll be taking the message of Pentecost
to turn the children to the faith of the fathers. Because he'll be rebuking them because if they didn't keep this same faith that was back there at the beginning. Amen. Now, I believe we pretty well realize it's going to be Elijah, don't we? Now, we know it. So this angel of this age was predicted all the way back in the Scripture, the Old Scriptures, beginning up of this age. It's Elijah, great anointed one. Now watch. What kind of a nature will Elijah have? First, he'll be a mighty prophet, true to the Word of God. For Elijah was true. John was true.
Amen.
That's right. Doing signs and wonders will turn the hearts of the children back to the faith of the Pentecostal fathers. He will hate denominations like Elijah did. That's right. He will. I think we just got the thing started for him now, about time he gets to come. He'll hate denominations. Elijah hated them. And so did John hate denominations. This prophet will be a lover of the wilderness. Like Elijah, he lived in the wilderness alone. John, in the wilderness alone. Then we know it's going to be Elijah. All right. This prophet will be one that will stay with the true Word of God.
Amen.
Yes, he'll stay with it. Oh, the Word. What to? To restore back a faith to the Ephesus church that's been lost all this time.
Amen.
Faith in a church that had an open door set before it and rejected it unto the angel of the Lord of Laodicea. Write these things which saith the Amen, the faithful and true witness, and the beginning of the creation of God. I know thy works, thou art neither cold nor hot. I would that thou were cold or hot. In other words, don't just be lukewarm. So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. Isn't that a command? That's a rebuke to this ungodly Laodicean age, the worst of the whole bunch. All the rest of them, the torments and everything they had nothing. They was poverty stricken, wandered about in sheepskins and goatskins and destituted and sawed and burnt to death and fed the lions and everything else and still held the faith. And this bunch is rich and have need of nothing and everything else and a prostitute. Now God said, I'd rather you be hot, real red hot, or freezing. Be one or the other. Don't get lukewarm because you make me sick. That's what this church age does for God, makes you sick. Just don't pretend something that you haven't got. Either be on fire for God or go on back into an organization. Don't be lukewarm. Many of these people are eloquent singers, eloquent men. Great man and so forth, instead of using their talent for God, the devil's perverted them. They're over there working for him. Personalities, radio or television personalities, selling their stuff out there for the world instead of giving it to God. And you, preacher, that'll go to a meeting because they give you more money than they do at some other place.
Amen.
You rascal. Hallelujah. You're not a fit to be in a pulpit.
Amen. Amen.
Yes. Brother, a real man of God would go with the Holy Ghost, let him read.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Glory. He had to eat soda crackers and drink branch water.
Amen.
Right.
Glory to God.
He's a real servant of God.
Yes.
But people tie themselves up with broadcast and radio and television and all kinds of things in the world until they got to have that kind of money.
Amen.
Amen.
Exactly right. See? That ain't God.
No.
He said, oh, you're rich, have need of nothing. Sure. But the very thing you had need of, you didn't have.
Amen.
Right, but you didn't know it. You're dead and don't know it!
Amen.
Yes. Oh, what's your stained glass windows going to amount to?
Yeah.
What's your fine plush pews and what's all your big congregation going as straight to hell as a Martin to its box? Or if you don't have the Spirit of God, you're lost. Unless you're born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. That's bitter. It's like I used to take castor oil. I said, Mama, I can't even stand it. She said, if it don't make you sick, it don't do you no good. So I guess that's about the way this do. Brother, the world, it won't be converted by money. The world will be converted by the Holy Ghost. Powerful preaching of the Holy Ghost and the cross will be the only thing that will convert the world. God's program is not money, it's the Holy Ghost. That's what God's program is. For the lady you see in church age or any other church age. Yes, sir. I counsel thee to come buy of me gold tried in the fire. A different kind of gold. Yeah. A gold that's tried in the fiery furnace, that went through the fire of death, that went through Calvary. Come out. But the gold that Jesus gives is the Holy Spirit. The golden oil of the Spirit pours into your heart. And oh my, counsel of you, come buy me gold if you want to get rich. Oh, yes. So then, that's it. Lady of sin, lukewarm, backslidden, nearsighted, I don't know what all. Let me tell you, a man that's born to the Spirit of God can take you plumb back to the day of Pentecost.
Hallelujah!
Pedigree!
Hallelujah!
Amen!
Amen!
I want to be Pentecost from the top of my head to the soles of my feet.
Amen! Hallelujah!
I don't mean the denominational Pentecost. I mean the real power of the resurrection of Christ.
Amen!
The real Pentecostal blessing.
Yes, sir.
Oh, naked and don't know it. Now that person's in a miserable fix. If a man is wretched, blind, miserable, naked, now if he knows it, he'll help himself.
Amen.
But if he don't know it, the poor fellow's mentally gone.
Yeah.
Is that right? Whew. That was kind of strong. Mentally gone. He doesn't know enough to help himself. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in and will sup with him, and he with me. To him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me on my throne, even as I also overcome and am set down with my Father in his throne. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the church. This is one of the most outstanding statements that I've ever seen in the New Testament. Is that right? We tell sinners Jesus is at the door knocking. But here, he's knocking at the church door.
Amen.
For he wants to walk with them.
Amen.
But they, with their organization and worldliness and coldness, had excluded him.
Amen.
He's on the outside of the church. This is the most striking record in the New Testament. I think there's nothing to be any more sadder than this.
Amen.
To see the Savior of the world took out of his own church. The lady of sin age. They spewed him out. And here was all of that still knocking at the door. Trying to get back in. What for? To give him eternal life. The very ones that killed him at Calvary, he was trying to save their soul. It's the most pathetic picture I've ever seen in my life. Ever thought of. Our Savior. When he was on earth, he was excluded from his own nation. He is rejected. He is excluded. The world excluded him and crucified him. And now, from his own church, he's excluded. He isn't wanted anywhere. He had no need of him. They got a denomination. They didn't need him. They got a pope, or they need with him anymore. They got an archbishop, a general overseer. They had no use for the Holy Ghost anymore. They didn't need that no more. And here he is at the last church age, standing outside the door. God Almighty, that breaks my heart today. My Lord, standing outside the door of his own church, after being pushed out by worldliness and coldness and denomination and indifference, standing outside the door, knocking, trying to get back in. Any man that will hear my voice and will open the door,
I will come in and sup with him, amen, and he with me.
Amen.
That's the message to the Pentecostal church. Not try to revive the Pentecostal organization, but revive the Pentecostal blessing in the individual's heart. That's the only way. And I will sup with him and him. What does the messenger to the church, message to the church teach us then? Teach us not the growth in the spirit. No, sir. Decline of the spirit. We have a decline all the time. Jesus ain't going to stand outside of your door and knock all the time.
Right.
There's a time when he'll get enough and turn away. Then you'll do the knocking, but you'll never find him.
That's right.
Come while it is time. Come while there is a knock.
Amen.
Don't you compromise with anything less than the baptism of the Holy Ghost, amen, like they got at Pentecost with the same type of water baptism, the same things that they did there. Don't you let nothing put anything in your heart less than that.
Amen.
I'm glad tonight that we had this message. And I'm so glad that you attended. And your attendance has been so appreciated by me. I'm grateful to Almighty God for him letting me see what I have seen and being able to deliver to this church. And now it's off my heart. For some time, the Holy Spirit dealt on my heart. I couldn't shake it away. I just had to go with it. And as his servant, I pray for you. I pray that God will give you the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And I wonder if you could do this in your heart, if you're sincere. If you would make this promise to God, God, I from this time standing on my feet seeking this baptism of the Holy Ghost, I shall constantly pray and wait until you fill me with the Holy Ghost. Will you make that promise to God, believe, raising your hands? I will constantly pray, constantly, until you fill me with sweetness and goodness of the Spirit. Now this morning we're going to try to tie, the Lord willing, some of those things in of the between the church ages. These right in here, there's something goes in. 144,000, the remnant, the sleeping virgin, the wise virgin, and the sealing of the Holy Ghost, marking of the beast, all those things. And the dark age of 1500, the Catholic hierarchy, when they was established in United Church and State together, that was a post-millennium. They thought that they were absolutely in the millennium because the church had received its vicar, one like Christ, to sit on a throne, and it would unite with the church and state, all had become well, and the great millennium was on. They still believe that. But that's an error. Because the millennium can't be issued in without the coming of Christ. Christ brings in the millennium.
Amen.
He's the Son of Prosperity. And when he comes in, will be 1,000 years. And when it is, there'll be the rapture of the church. She'll go up. And then the return of Christ. And remember now, what's the next thing we're looking for? The rapture of the church.
Amen.
Now remember, we're going to deal on that sharply this morning. You're either in that body or out of that body. No halfway between it. There's no pretty good Christians, and you're either Christians or you're not Christian. We have this new birth now, which is a spiritual that breeds out all the call. And we are new creatures in Christ Jesus, born again of the Spirit of God. New creatures. There is a remnant of Jews to be saved. And there is a Jew, which is a cast off, because giving us a chance. There is a lukewarm church, and there is a spirit-filled church. Now this remnant was the sleeping virgin, the unbeliever. I put that U-B, unbeliever. And that's the sinner. And here is another one, which is a formal, I put F-O, formal church. And then here is the other one, which is the saved church, S-A, the saved church. Now keep them in mind all the time. Now in this saved church,
There's two classes in this church right here and right here, which was type of Christ. One of them was a sleeping virgin, and the other one had oil in the lamp. Now, first, before we do that, we're going to the 144,000 of Revelation 7, so that it can really be understood. After these things, I saw four angels standing on the four corners of the earth, holding the four winds, that they should not blow upon the earth, or on the sea, or any tree. And I saw another angel descending from the east, having the seal of the living God, and he cried with a loud voice to the four angels to whom it was hurt. It was given to hurt the sea and the earth, saying, hurt not the earth, neither the sea or tree, until we have sealed the servants of our God in their forehead. Now remember, the servants has always been God's servants, is the Jew. Abraham was his servant. The Gentile is not a servant. It's a bride. It's a son. This is the son. The church is. The Jews are the servants. So just remember, trace that through the Bible, and you'll find that the Jew is God's servant. Now, you see, and then all of Jerusalem was destroyed. Now this year is perfectly a parallel. Revelation 7. Now watch. From the time of Titus besieging Jerusalem within the world, there hasn't been a time down through history that all the world went to war until 1914. Now listen close. And so then, this, all of them was marching to war, you well remember, in 1914. Now isn't it strange? Right in the decline of the world's war, I have the volumes of it, volume 2 about page 44, that they do not know to this day who stopped that war. It was God that stopped it. Amen. To fulfill his word. That was just at the breaking of Pentecost. Back in 1906, 1914, down there. Now, to see whether this message that we got is connected with it or not, the very hour that Israel was signed in to be a nation, it was the very same hour, very same day, very same month, everything else. I was at Greensville, Indiana, when that angel there appeared to me and set me out on the field with this. Actually, it met me down on the river and told me what would take place. They commissioned me 11 years later at the same hour that Israel was signed in as a nation. It's all connected together. See, the angel of the Lord is on earth now. See, he's moving around, fixing everything for the coming of the Lord. And one angel went down in one state with Abraham, the elect. Sodom was down here, and Lot was in Sodom. And two angels went down there and preached to them and brought that little bitty group out, sleeping virgin.
Amen.
See? All right, but see? With that intellectual preaching, the thing here's here, but he's trying to jerk out Solomon, trying to jerk out or give grace to that sleeping virgin.
Amen.
But here was Abraham in his class, and Jesus said, as it was in the days of Sodom, so shall it be in the coming of the Son of Man. And then there was a space given then for the Gentiles as they come down to this age. Then there's 3.5 years left yet for the Jews. Now watch to prove that they're Jews. Now I'm going to take the saying, hurt not the earth, neither the sea, or any tree, until we seal the servants of our God in their forehead. Now to prove that this revelation is right, watch this, the fourth verse. And I heard the number of them were sealed, and there were sealed 144,000, all of the tribes of the children of Israel. Israelites. Where are they at? They're just now gathered. They're up there ready, waiting for the sealing time to come. Of the tribe of Judah was sealed 12,000. Tribe of Reuben, 12,000. Tribe of Gad, 12,000. Asher, 12,000. Nephilim, 12,000. And on, Simeon, and on down to Benjamin, the 12 tribes. And 12 times 12 is 144,000. See? Now that's the one. Now if you look in the 14th chapter, just a moment, here you see. And I looked, and lo, a lamb stood on Mount Sinai, and with him 144,000, having his father's name written in their forehead. Mount Sinai, the lamb had come back from the rapture, and come back, as we talked the other night, as Joseph dismissed all the Gentiles. When he stood by his brother, the Jews always believed their prophets. We all know that. Because God told them that the Messiah would be a prophet. It'll be a secret coming. No one knows what's going to happen. We don't meet him first. We meet one another first. And the dead in Christ shall rise first. And we which are alive and remain shall be changed. Standing and feel a change come on. The gray hair go out. The wrinkles fall away. Be changed in a moment and a twinkling of an eye. And we shall meet our loved ones first. And then together with them that were dead, says the scripture, we'll be caught up in the air to meet the Lord. The order of the coming. There comes your 144,000. We'll receive the gospel after we can't receive it at the same time. The light is on the Gentiles. The Jews are denying it and hiding it. Now, when the Gentiles is taken up, then the Spirit comes up on two to give witness to them. Then the Jews receive it, which is 144,000 of the lost tribes of Israel will receive the gospel. And the bride is taken away. Now there's 10 virgins. Let's strike Matthew 21. Then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened to 10 virgins which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. Now, and 5 of them were wise, and 5 were foolish. And they that were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. While the bridegroom tarried, that's through these church ages, they slumbered and slept. And at midnight there was a cry made, Behold, the bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him. And all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps, and the foolish said unto the wise, Give us of your oil, for our lamps are gone out. But the wise answered, saying, Not so, lest there be not enough for us and you. But go ye rather to them that sell, and buy for yourselves. Pardon me. And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came. And they that were ready went in with him to the marriage. And the door was shut. Afterwards came also the other virgins, saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. Now see, there wasn't unbelievers. It's good people. Open to us. But he answered and said, Verily I say unto you, I know you not. Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour whence the Son of Man shall come. Now watch, both of them were virgins. If you'll take that name virgin and run it down, it means holy, clean, sanctified. So the Greek word for clean is sanctified. The Hebrew word is holy. Holy, clean, and sanctified is all the same word. So this was not a filthy, dirty church. It was a sanctified, clean church. 10 virgins went out to meet the bridegroom. What does it mean? All these churches. Not down here in the Roman, but down into the denominations. All of them went out to meet the bridegroom. Now, there was the virgins went out to meet him and the foolish virgins. Now, did not have oil in their lamp, but they had everything else. They were clean. They believed in Christ. They preached the word. If they believed, their denomination let them preach. This one could not go in where there was no oil in the lamp. They went back to pray up to receive the Holy Ghost, but while they were gone, it was all over. Now you get it? While they went to buy, they're trying to buy now. All the church is trying to have a revival. Revival is trying to go back. Here goes the church home. It goes home. Here is the remnant that's left over. And here is the 144,000 on Mount Sinai of the Jews. Amen. Not 3 different brides. It's the bride, the remnant, and the 144,000. Exactly. Now remember, as I said, everything's in a three. His coming is in a three. The first time he came to redeem his bride. The second time he comes to catch away his bride, like a love affair. Comes around, steals her out at nighttime, takes her away from the world. Meet him in the air. The secret coming of the Lord. See? The second time he comes is to receive his bride. First time to redeem her. Second time to receive her. And the third time with her. King and queen. Oh, don't you love him?
Amen.
Oh, I love him.